Hello and welcome to the Grand Line Review, your source for everything One Piece. And today we have a review of Chapter 961, The Mountain God Incident. And this week primarily presented a nice piece of action, resolving the mountain boar business that was set up during the last chapter, as well as a bit of intrigue towards the end. However, I do think that the biggest takeaway from 961 is that Odin is more than likely an individual targeted by circumstance. Chapter 960 went to a lot of effort to let us in on Odin's so-called exploits, but I think that this chapter provides the element of truth behind most of, if not all of those events. Because it doesn't feel to me like Odin is some delinquent who goes on to recklessly cause all of these incidents. However, he is there to resolve them and take responsibility for them, which is what has led to his poor reputation up until this point. That and the fact that Odin's honorable actions are not generally seen as such by the public. Case in point last week when he was introduced dining atop the remains of an acquaintance. But like every case of misunderstanding, there are always first-hand witnesses who do know the truth of the matter. In this case being Kinemon, Denjiro, and a selection of other members of the capital. And I feel like that is going to be a very key aspect going forward. And you know, when I think about it, right now, Odin kind of mirrors Luffy somewhat, with his ability to charm people and make allies through his actions. At the same time, Luffy can also put a lot of people off with his more unconventional moves, and is perceived by the world as a terrifying pirate threat, having caused a series of incidents of his own, garnering a reputation just as bad, if not worse, than Odin. They also have very similar desires of setting out to the open seas and adventuring across the world. You know, I feel like if Luffy had been born on Wano, then this is more or less exactly how he would have turned out. Brash, powerful, and with a strong sense of desire to see the world outside of its borders. So with that in mind, I'm having a very good time getting to know Odin because of that sense of familiarity and the knowledge that characters like this seem to go on to have a profound effect in the world, which we are already seeing in the current timeline. Plus, the entire sequence with him and the Mountain God was wonderfully drawn as well, with the big focus being on the moment where he cut it down and saved the residents of the capital. But my favorite panel of the chapter was actually when Odin first jumped into the fray and was holding the young boar above him with one hand. I love the depth of the shading on Odin's semi-silhouetted figure, as well as the mountain god itself, which had such a wonderful side glance of sheer rage directly at Odin. And then to contrast all of that, you have the baby boar drawn perfectly normally, like it's in way over its head in this situation. I really appreciate this panel though, because I feel like every other shot of the mountain god lacks that sense of fear that we should be feeling in regards to a creature of this size. In the other panels, the mountain god is drawn fairly flatly, and it does look like just a big old pigum. However, this one panel, thanks to fairly simple shading and composition, does wonderfully to convey the threat that this creature is and why it is called the Mountain God. And while the god would appear to be disposed of, it does make me wonder what happened to the younger boar and if it will be at all relevant in the future. Like when we come back to the current timeline, is it going to make an appearance in its adult form, now the size of the Mountain God we saw in this chapter, and play, you know, a small part in future events? It might seem like an odd thing for me to focus on, but Oda does do that sort of thing with animals. The best example I can think of off the top of my head is Nola, who appeared in the Nolan to Kalgara flashback during Skypiea, and who was revealed to be the Lord of the Sky in the current timeline. Nothing major, but just a nice little piece of connectivity. Like, I wouldn't be surprised to see another mountain god popping up down the line. Now, with all of this focus on Odin, I also don't want to forget Kinemon. Odin got all of the glory here, but Kinemon holds the emotional weight of this chapter, which is once again surprising because, well, it's Kinemon. It was fantastic to see him hopeless going up against the mountain god though, and I really could feel his sheer determination to get Tsuru back. I think the last handful of Wano chapters have really shown me a new side to Kinemon that I never would have thought possible when we first encountered him. Well, when we encountered parts of him during the Punk Hazard arc. He's becoming a much stronger presence to me and a better character in general, so I'm quite excited to see him continue to grow, even though it will probably be in a most tragic manner. Actually, maybe not, because he and Tsuru do get married eventually, so maybe we'll see that in this flashback. That would be a nice jolt of joy. Now, the other undeniable presence in this chapter is that twist of intrigue I mentioned before with the introduction of a young Orochi, who rather sadly fits into all of this as Yasu's manservant. And actually, just on that, it was a bit of a hit in the gut to see Yasu again, especially immediately followed by Orochi. You know, just knowing how he met his demise and everything, it was just, ah. But it is interesting to see how Orochi is beginning to fit into all of this, because it would seem that he has a proper rags-to-riches story going on, starting from humble beginnings as one of society's lowest-ranking members, rising all the way to the shogun of the entire nation. Now, knowing Orochi, we know that this journey will be much less earned than it will be a result of foul play. That's almost certain. But I guess the thing about placing Orochi here is that he has access to the inner circle of the Kozuki clan, so that perhaps when this whole Kaido business does eventually drop, he will be pretty fantastically positioned to betray the clan just due to the level of access he has. But what I'm most interested to explore is if Oda is going to try and redeem Orochi at all, or just leave him as a bad guy for the sake of being a bad guy. And right now, I'm honestly not sure which I would prefer at this very moment, because yeah, there is a chance that he becomes a more empathetic antagonist as a result of this flashback, with a little seed being planted here of Odin calling him a creep. You know, this could be the beginning of a very toxic association for Orochi, who perhaps after many years of being berated over and over by Odin, just breaks and decides to betray the Kozuki clan. Like, yes, he is an undeniable twisted little shit in modern day, but he doesn't necessarily need to start out that way here. It would be very interesting to see him start out with legitimately good intentions in life, and to then see him being corrupted into the vat of scum that he is today. But I don't know that that is the direction Oda's going to take. A much more likely scenario in my mind is that Orochi goes through this flashback always possessing a more sinister and ambitious mindset. But we'll just have to see, I guess. As for other miscellaneous parts of the chapter, I've seen a few people pointing out just how similarly that priest who appeared randomly looks to Holden. In fact, their similarities are almost impossible to deny, with the exception of the whiskers, which would have been Devil Fruit inflicted. Other than that, they have a practically identical face. With that said, I highly doubt that it is Holden, because that would surely make Holden like 60 to 70 years old in the modern timeline, which, I don't know, I just don't see him being that old. The other option, of course, is that he is a relative of Holden, which I'm very much on board with, because this isn't like a Denjiro-Koshiro comparison. These facial features are pretty much exactly alike, and that is most certainly intentional. So yeah, I guess of all the characters we could be exploring, Holden also has some stake in this flashback, oddly enough. And I also want to mention Denjiro briefly once again. He, despite being a popping element of the last chapter, didn't really have a presence here whatsoever to me. Which isn't to say that he needs one, what this chapter did was fine, and I understand how Denjiro ended up following Odin, etc. But immediately after finishing the chapter, I forgot that he was in it altogether. Going back on things, Denjiro did have that nice moment of admiration for Odin with that starry gaze and everything. So that is most certainly a sign that wherever or whoever Denjiro is, he is 100% on the side of the Kozuki clan. So, you know, if say Kyoshiro is just Denjiro wearing a wig or something, then he would most certainly be joining the side of the scabbards. And I both love and hate that idea, because I quite enjoy Kyoshiro as an antagonistic element in the series, but there's just too much about him that flags Ally in Disguise, especially with the whole Hiyori event. Whatever the case, by the end of this flashback, I guarantee that we'll have an answer regarding Denjiro in the current timeline. And finally, as I do like to do these days, let's briefly examine the cover story, because we are getting closer and closer to finding Lola. Vito and Gotti have stumbled upon the victims of some sort of assault conducted by wildly large lips. And you know, it would seem to obviously be Lola, but perhaps that's a bit too obvious. Because Oda takes some very weird directions in these cover stories, and often sets up red herrings like this. Like, I can see a situation where we get to the cover story of chapter 962, and it has Vito and Gotti finding the perpetrator, and it's an Okama or something, who has been rampaging through Dressrosa, and then the Fire Tank Pirates will get caught up in a separate mini-event to stop that whole thing. And this sort of misdirection is actually incredibly common, like it happened during Ace's cover story when he was searching for Blackbeard and found Dr. Blackbeard instead, but hints have also been shown of it happening in this very cover story last week, when Beige himself found two people who looked exactly like Lola from behind. And we're also very early into this story, so I don't expect us to find Lola quite this quickly. But even so, the story continues to be a lot of fun nonetheless, and I love that Gotti has to cover up his gigantic arm to try and blend in with polite society. But that pretty much does it for chapter 961. If you enjoyed this video and the content this channel produces in general, then please do consider donating to the Grand Line Review Patreon, because the support of all of you amazing people is what continues to make this channel possible. And if you'd like to see more videos like this, but apply to other anime and manga series, then please do check out my second channel, New World Review, for all of your wider needs. And if you'd like to join the fun at any time, then please do head over to my Discord server, where a wide array of shenaniganry takes place on a daily basis. And finally, please do comment with your thoughts on the chapter. This has been the Grand Line Review, and I'll see you next time. Do you want / expect any major character death in the Wano arc? I mean, I think want is definitely the wrong way to put it. But the character that I do expect to die is Kaido. I know that generally primary One Piece characters don't die, even villains, but a lot of his character has been set up around the fact that he can't be killed for whatever reason. So at this point in time, I feel like his death would be one way of bringing whatever story he has going on full circle, except that I don't think he'll be killed, rather he may finally commit suicide and succeed. Are you looking forward to the Straw Hat Alliance realizing that they have to fight two Yonkos at the same time? Firstly, Yonko is the plural of Yonko, but yes, very much so. In fact, I'm still quite shocked that they don't know this already. Kaido and Big Mom weren't exactly subtle in their formation of an alliance, and I feel like if Kinemon had any source within Kaido's legion whatsoever, then that information would have been discovered by now. But I do have to admit that discovering it on the battlefield would lead to one hell of a huge reaction. If One Piece is so great, why isn't there a Two Piece? You know what? Fair criticism there.